Today, I'll tell you about the EBP app user stack trace issue and my solutions. I'm Eunsun Lee from LG Electronics. I'm developing debugging tools using EBP app. And these tools are based on, these tools are designed for various systems, including resource-constrained embedded devices. And I'm working with the open source for this goal. Today's topic is the result of resolving common issues. BCC is one of the most famous open source projects that provides many useful tools and development environment for EBP app. I'd like to introduce two patches I developed during this project. First of all, let me tell you about the motivation. Next, I'll explain stack trace a little for better understanding. Then I will go to the issue. I'll go to the EBPF user stack trace issue and its cause. I approached in two ways, based on the online information of target program. The first case is for the target program with the warp online table. And second case is for the target program with no online information. One day, I profiled my test program with profile tool of BCC, and I expected this stack trace. But I got this. Who took the rest of my call chain? So I looked up the issue in this open source EBPF project, and I found that many others are experiencing the same issue as I am. So, and those issues are still open. And I got to know that the maintainers are waiting for a solution to the issue. So, to get my stack trace back, I developed two solutions. This is the result of one of my solutions. Today, I present my two approaches and their respective solutions. Before we dive into the issue, let's understand stack trace first. In a code with a call path like this, the stack frames are stacked like this. Before stacking a new stack frame, the return address is backed up in the stack. So, if we want to obtain the stack trace at this point, we divide the stack into each frame and collect the return addresses from each frame, then it becomes the stack trace. These are common methods for obtaining stack trace. The frame pointer is a method that utilizes a register to indicate the beginning of the current frame. When a new frame is created, the return address, the frame pointer's value is stored in the stack. So, by tracing the frame pointer values, we can obtain the stack trace. The unwind table is a method for calculating the start of each frame using the stack pointer and a table with offsets. The table is included in the binary as a section at compile time. Each frame and debugger frame are based on the dwarf format, which is one of the most widely used formats. This is for ARM. This is a kernel-specific format. And there are also other methods designed for specific CPU or applications. Now, Let's go to the issue and its cause. This is the general architecture of eBPF tools. The user program generates BPF bytecode and loads it into the kernel and attaches it to trace events like a trace point. Whenever the trace event occurs, it triggers the BPF program. Then the BPF program runs and saves data to BPF map if it wants. For stack trace, the BPF program calls this function of BPF helper, which gets the stack trace of target program and stores them to BPF map. Finally, the user program reads the data from BPF map, manipulates the data, and reports it to the user. This function of BPF helper delegate the stack trace acquisition to PARP, and PARP handles user and kernel stack trace differently. For kernel stack trace, PARP provides simple dwarf unwinder, ORC unwinder, and frame pointer based unwinder. But for user stack trace, PARP provides only frame pointer based unwinder. Kernel doesn't care the requirement to use these unwinder tables now. This is the cause of the issue. In the kernel, dwarf unwinder was tried but failed, and there are no plans to support it now. Actually, I don't know well about the history, but as I know, there were many issues in dwarf unwinder in the kernel due to the complexity of dwarf format, so Tobias doesn't like it. So, to solve the issue, several approaches are being tried now. Today, I will introduce my two items. And for your information, there are other approaches as well. My first approach is for the target program with dwarf unwinder table. I simply approached it. How does PARP solve this? PARP supports these options to get user stack trace. Among these, dwarf is the option for the target program with dwarf unwinder table. During the record phase, PARP dumps stacks to PARP.data. Then in the replay phase, PARP utilizes ribbonwind to obtain the stack trace from the dumped stack and the unwinder table of target program. Then, what is ribbonwind? Ribbonwind is an open source library for stack unwinding. It's used by widely used debuggers like GDB. It provides compatibility support for various architectures, operating systems, and these unwind tables. If we look at closely ribbonwind takes the task of analyzing these unwind tables in various architectures. So PARP can achieve its goal efficiently by delegating the unwinding process to ribbonwind. I brought that concept in eBPF. This is the part I worked on. The BPF program dumps stacks of target program to BPF map, and the user program reads the data from BPF map and utilizes a ribbonwind to obtain the stack trace in the same way as PARP. It supports these architectures now and can be expanded easily with ribbonwind. Here are the test results. This comes from the PC register. So, we dwarf online table. Now you can see complete user stack trace. And this is what is saw in the prologue. But relying on RibbonMind, we can delegate several issues like compatibility, architecture expansion, and table type expansion. But it has resource overhead. It requires as much resources per push to unwind. Now, let's go to the second approach. It's put a target program with no unwind information. So, why we have to care about this case? Of course, perfect stack trace is the best, if possible, but it costs. For the frame pointer, we dedicate one general purpose register and generate additional instructions for function, for each function to store its value in the stack. So we have to put up with the cost of time at compile and run, even when we don't need a stack trace. So it's omitted by default in compilers. In case of the unwind table, you have to pay more memory and disk spaces and time for loading. It also needs a compile option to use. Hardware support would be useful, but hardware is a cost itself. So, some environments are not willing to pay the cost. Resource-constrained environments like embedded devices are one such case, and there are also other cases. As you know, in this case, it's almost impossible to show the user stack trace. Then, do you have to give up the better result? How about having a fail-safe option? So, this is my second solution. Scan the stack and collect any text addresses encountered. The idea originated from dump stack of x86 in kernel. In this figure, you can see that the BP program dumps stack of target program and collect any text addresses and stores them into bpmap. Then, user program reads the data and reports it to the user. In the test result, now you can get kind of user stack trace that can be used as a hint. I call this sudo user stack trace from now. The result of stack scanning may contain inaccurate entries. When you have such code, local variables reside in the stack. Function pointer variables can hold the text addresses. And uninitialized local variables might contain garbage text addresses. So it's possible to apply a validity check. PL is an instruction for function call in ARC64. Typically, the address of instruction following PL is used as a return address. So, if the instruction of previous line is PL, we can identify the scanned text address as a return address. This cannot be definitely proven, but I think T this heuristic could be useful in production. This is before applying the check. This line in the red box are false entries. This line is caused by function pointer variable. You can get better result after applying. So, you can get pseudo user stack trace without any unwind information. It's pretty simple. It's available for all architectures. It can be useful for embedded devices, and the architecture where even frame pointer doesn't work, such as ARM. And as you know, it's not 100% reliable. The current patch is implemented with BPF program, but due to the kernel change, it's only available before Linux version 6.1. So I'm planning to try adding it to kernel BPF helper. Add a new flag for stack scanning for this BPF helper function and returns the scanned result to the BPF stack trace map. It's tested in the latest Linux kernel. I introduce one use case of post-unwinding with ribbon-wind solution for a practical issue of PCC. A user posed this issue, and this is the result of frame pointer-based unwinding. And he reports some lines are missing when using a new operator of C++. And he reports the stack trace is complete when using my post-dwarf unwind solution. It can be a useful use case. Thank you. Do you have any questions? I couldn't listen, so.
When, you know, typically programs before they're shipped on devices, they're stripped of the debug symbol.
Yeah.
In that case, is the unwind strategy still available?
The second solution could be available. The first solution is not available, but as I know, the debug information can be deliverable. It's deliverable. For example, you can install apt-get install with debugger, debug info. Yeah, so it could be some kind of cost of unwinding.